something, but essentially it's just thinking about, we want to move needs to there, getting observations out, hearing one another's perspectives and needs, which more sits here, and then moving it up into what you intend. Today you're into showing us with your, when you're doing your brown paper exercises, what you think is, and what you intend to be the new process, and then what we'll have to do is try and amalgamate them together and look at where all the commonalities are, and then have a discussion about, okay, so, because one of the things that leaders get confused about, I'll go to clients sometimes and say to them things like, oh yeah, we want this new culture, we want everyone to be empowered, and I say, okay, so let's maybe in this exercise just consult people and something. Oh no, don't do that, because then what do you do with all the ideas? And sorry, that was a Karen, that was never Karen. And it's because leaders get scared of, well, okay, tell me to open up discussion, and then what do I do with all these ideas? And there's different ways we can do that. So I don't know how much you're going to agree or disagree today, but there's different ways we can try to get a sense of understanding. Maybe we can't resolve everything today, and that's fine, but it's getting probably, you know, 90% there, or 85% there, and then looking at how we can make some trade-offs. Okay? So that's really the skill of getting leaders moving up. Moving people up here is dealing with multiple viewpoints, etc. Okay, so what I'd like to do now, this is where we're now going to move. I'm just thinking of time. Come on, time check. What are we going to do? Karen, have you got the timetable there? Budget managers
Thursday.
So what's the consequence? I don't see consequences.
So if you were to encourage us to have more children, what can we do to make sure that people don't overspend?
Elements that then make it to manual or manual, and then there's a bit that then goes on to SharePoint, it's a few bits or something in the digital or more of an IT solution. I know people are talking, oh, it'd be great to get an automated response that says approved, you know immediately it's been approved, if it's an app. And then there's been an issue raised about duplications where there are sometimes different sub processes and different teams because of the need of an approver to want to see documentation or whatever before it, but then it goes one way and then it goes the other way through them. It gets because there's a fear of not trusting the process, but how quickly they also submit it. So the application gets submitted twice, once through their local route and through the formal route. And what happens is it gets caught eventually, but you've got a duplication and end up with HR sector 2 applications, and then you realise that it's for the same thing. Because there's a lot of lack of trust. So well, let's check that out and get quicker than the other. So that's not true for every service team, but it's true for some. So generally, that was the key issue we had in the meeting. Actually, is there an actual risk? Has it been over exaggerated? So what I'd like to do, I'm just going to get different post-it notes. If you feel there's things missing from this, then just come and write them down. I'll just get more notes and put them up on the wall, and I'll ask you to share them with the team. So I'm just going to. Work. Like we've heard things today about, well, maybe if we communicated this earlier, maybe if we had these conversations earlier, maybe if we were clearer about the outcome or if we provided this evidence or whatever. So think about that. Well, for this to work for me in my role, this is what I need from other people to make it work. And also just think of your tick list of criteria. Up on the wall there, we talk about one of the intensive practices to inspire design. We talk a lot about your criteria to guide this decision making. What's the tick list if we're ticking off? What is it we've got to tick to know that it's the right decision? And often that's to do with evidence, what evidence needs to be provided, etc. So think, goals and outcomes, information needs, what I need from others, our
key criteria for our role in order to make this new system a success, and this is what it's got to fulfil. We asked you to do some pre-work, thinking about some questions, just thinking about your frustrations, which you'll have got up in here, thinking about your role and where you sort of saw your role as a check, as an approver, as somebody who's needed information afterwards, or another role. Thinking about your answers to these. And we're just going to give, we'll give you 10 minutes to start off with if you need more shout. So what I'd like to ask is randomly, if I could ask finance to sit over here. If I could ask...
Start with Jarvis. Right, so I'm going to ask you to feed back in your role group so that everyone gets absolute clarity on what you need and you're going to get suggestions into the process. I'll pack the bill up on the flip chart, finance, team management team, HR, etc. And then we're going to move into working in mixed groups to try to design this now that you've all got a great understanding of what one another needs. So, if we start. In terms of trying to get this, let's start with service first, that bottom up approach in terms of going to the users, going to the information, and then we'll do service, then HR, then finance, then SMT. So who would like to feedback for the, there's two service teams, one for schools and one for, right, so who would like to go first?
I was told it was a team effort, but my team argued that it didn't open it. I was just writing what I was told to write, and they just said it's too soon. Okay, I'll give you round top three.
Yes.
And then our role. So top three.
So yeah. I'll get it.
So when you're thinking about your project, thinking about what is the Lego, and the Lego here is what is it that you absolutely can't change? So if HR says, whatever, so is there any example of where if HR says, you know, if they're giving advice it's, or reminding you of the risks, when is it you have to absolutely follow it, and when is it that a budget manager can choose to listen to it, but actually choose to ignore it because you can justify it for these, but you have to then take responsibility and accountability for that decision. And when is it there's a very clear label? So what's the label for HR?
We need to be taking something
from
the skills register.
Right, so the label for HR is still there. That's required. Because it's a legal requirement, is that right?
And the job account.
And the
job account.
The job account. So that's the
modern
apprentice. That's the advantage. So if HR says we can hear that can fill this post, you have to use them.
Look at the label of all three post to all families. Because when you roll out to all families, it means that lack of flexibility about being able to employ the resources within the job class and our levels takes priority over new recruitment. Finance, Scottish Europe Club.
Scottish Europe Club.
Sorry.
Teachers.
Committee.
Compulsory medical transfer of staff.
Compulsory
transfer of teachers. That's not the staff position.
Okay, Brett, I'm going to ask the same question to finance. What's your label?
I've got £947.
number 7, so clearly I feel that she's been doing a job.
I need to get the light away. That's a pleasant conversation with everyone. Okay, SMT,
which is only me, so it's not really SMT.
Relevant is the label here. Is there a label for you that I need? This is an under-
their corporate responsibilities. So sometimes what we will find in a practical sense is that you'll maybe have two English teachers coming through EAP from two separate establishments. But finance and HR know that in 4 weeks' time, we're going to have to redeploy an English teacher from another school. So the question then is, who then, which establishment has to forego the opportunity to recruit to that post, and which establishment has to take the redeployment? So there are certain brokering situations that happen within SMT because there is nowhere else for that situation to take place. So there are a number of, I think, systemic things that come through SMT that basically rely on somebody to broker that situation.
This is not happening elsewhere.
Yes.
Right, so what?
Look at what might come up or what might not, and they have months of worry for hope, to the point where we actually ensure information is taken in, and there's a balance for us to be thinking about that. But it has an impact, certainly, on how we think about what we're doing to people when we're recruiting to posts.
What questions have you got there to give yourself clarity, particularly in service teams and finance team? Is there anything you need to ask that will give you more clarity?
Come on, dear. There's a question here.
There's others, but it's not really no helpful for today. There's a recruitment process. I think maybe should, I was to hear when the start chamber was going. And I'm really concerned that maybe it could be received and delayed to the start chamber. SNP making decisions and things that sometimes should be left at a level below them. I'm thinking about how long do you take when you're discussing a job, for example? How long do you take? 4 or 5 minutes? Is it longer?
The only time you discuss posts there, because we've usually done the work before, is if they're being held.
Yeah. So I think basically, I like the idea that when you're at a new level, I'm not sure it's an SNP level, no. Or whatever. No. I'm not sure.
Is that head of service?
I think it's basically the budget holder and the service manager. If you want to take it to the head of service, that'd be a decent way forward. I'm not sure I agree with some things in manner which you cascade or any cascade information to every service that maybe put up for savings or specific jobs that we put up for savings. I know it's different in other areas, perfectly those other services we maybe have the difficult conversations as soon as they know. I know the children and family social work sometimes they don't have that big because we shouldn't make people anxious before the day. I think for me and my team, I think we'd like to be viewed as adults and get information as soon as we possibly can. I mean, whether your job's up for savings or not for savings, or whether your service is up for savings. And like all others, we make informed choices. But it's not an easy way forward.
No,
I just think basically as far as the recruitment process, I think the SNP in this time of very, very difficult business environment could have that help me going there. They'll need a bit more level.
Absolutely. So interestingly, I listened to this discussion. There comes across there's an element of what the responsibility and empowered budget manager is, and it's a bit like in democratic terms, and I'd encourage you to think about it. So for every freedom we expect in a democracy, there are responsibilities attached to it. So people who say things like, oh, you know, to talk about freedom, people should be able to say what they want, whatever, it's like, well, actually, if you want the right to have freedom of speech, there's also some responsibilities attached to that in terms of the level of things you cause, whatever, or the what you can, so it's not just enough to say you can have that right, it's about you've got some responsibilities attached to it. And I guess that's what I'd encourage you all to think about as well. We're going to move to the next segment now, which is what is the responsibility, and making a very clear responsibility of a budget holder, and what they have got to accept responsibility for and accountability for. And if they are getting clean information, then you can make much more informed decisions. People don't want to make them. It's a bit like I worked years ago for the government department, the Department of Trade and Industry. And I remember I was a change manager and I used to submit things like this. I'm not going to say which role did this, but they used to look at my things to the Director General and go, no, don't say that. No, don't be honest about that. No, no. So, anything else you want to do for other people to understand and respect in terms of what you need from the new process or any criteria to tick box for it to be successful?
And that's an interesting
thing you should say. Okay. And in fact, what's the question from other people? So, for you to do your bit well, I'm hearing you look a bit more realistic as to stop having to duplicate information, anything else in terms of thinking about your needs. Communicate to other people in the room if you need to know.
The
instructions, that each group has a copy of the instructions. There's five floating around, five sets of instructions are floating around, so make sure you've got that. And on that is colour coding. So you notice that there are, these sticky notes. And the colour coding is finance is green, service is pink, orange is HR, and HR will look afterwards at how that splits down. It's not for you to worry about the different roles in HR. And SMT or whatever it is you think the category is, because it might not even be relevant anymore. I don't know if it was a discussion to speak. And then there's additional things here for you to use, using pens, whatever you are, using your brown paper to try to basically map out the process. And this is your starting point. You need a post to be filled. What has to happen to get the job to be advertised? So we're not doing the rest of the EAP, it's just up to the job to be advertised. That end of the process where it goes on to the Job Scotland. Okay? So what is it that needs to happen? So we want you to design a flow and colour code it with different roles, with post-it notes or pens. On top of that, if it's an approval, you can make it A. If it's just information that people need, make it I. If it's a check, make a check or whatever anything else is, okay? But just to be clear of what that role is performing. So I want you to think about the IBL, think about the PKC priorities you heard this morning. We've talked a lot about statutory obligations, you heard about the requirements and the strategic context. I'm going to give you a little bit of top up on some IBL principles just to help you think about it. I think we've begun to cover quite a few of them off. Think about it in terms of, for this role, is it about giving an intention, or is it about making the actual decision, or is it making a very clear recommendation to someone else with an intentions and all the evidence, or is it about decision? So what's intention, what's checks, what's approvals, and for some, is it just visibility afterwards in terms of information? Offline conversations versus needing a physical process or a digitised process in some way. Be really clear, so you've just heard Sharon talk about, it's the assurance we need that somebody else has done the brokering, or for Holly, who was talking about where I come, to be able to talk about the criteria and evidence to know that you've gone and done these things. So what's the criteria and evidence that a budget manager needs to provide to give people the comfort? And that whole thing about who needs information pushed to them versus where you need to pull it, etc. Think about what information does the SMT have to give recruiting managers to give them visibility of their priorities or to give them visibility of savings, and how could that work? And then finally think about what are the conditions that need to be put in place to make it easy for people to work in this way and comply with it and to want to take the responsibility and to want to be accountable. So I used the recycling example earlier, where in Australia they made it really easy for people, they just created all the facilities, they were outside their door, there was regular pickups. We took years to get there because we focused in a different way, we didn't make it easy enough. And that's really what we mean about creating the conditions and the environment, thinking about what needs to happen to make it easy, whether it's mechanisms or communications, how you define roles, what goes into job descriptions to remind people of the responsibilities, whatever it is. That is essentially your task to work in a team to do. Now, are you comfortable if we do three mixed? She'd rather know than not. It's how you position it. So I positioned it in a very solution-focused way and said, well, this is the issue, this is the solution, it's got this consequence, but we've got any of your options, whatever. And she said to me, do you know, that's my biggest fear in my role as a Director General is that I think people, it's difficult to, I procrastinate. I don't sometimes want to make a decision because I'm not sure I'm informed, because I'm not sure I've got the right information, and people are giving me the right information, and people tell me what they think I want to hear rather than what I need to hear. And what I'm really glad about is being really honest. At which point my boss bursts in sort of through the door, exhausted because he's been running up the stairs because he's obviously like, what the hell is she telling him? What the hell is she telling her? And it was that whole thing of, it can happen, people can feel, can procrastinate with decisions at a very senior level, but it also happens all the time at more service levels and budgetary levels in organisations. And often it's, do I have the information? And am I the one that's going to be held accountable? And then what? And so then the blame culture starts, and it's easier to just do your bit and pass the buck. And that's what we've really got to resolve here, that if people want more control, and if you want control of your budgets, let's be really clear on the responsibilities. Because you sound as though you've got a lot of the information, you sound as though you feel you can make informed decisions, but that's not necessarily. You seem to know more sometimes than other people do, and it's about giving everybody that information. So think about the responsibilities of a budget manager that makes very clear the conversations they need to have, but in return, what information they need from other people to create these transparent processes. Is that helpful? So that's where everybody else wants to say.
I just wanted to say, I suppose that's right. But there's that added extra about that corporate responsibilities. So, you've got to do what's right for your establishment and your service. But if decisions are going to be made in the low SMT level, there is that brokering part of the accountabilities that if you want to make decisions 99% of the time within your own area, you need to take into account that corporate responsibility across the whole service and take part in that process as well.
Thank you. So before we move on to the prototyping, what questions do you have? So that you can move in an informed way. There may be none, there may be some, but again, it's your time to say.
That would come through EAP, there's very little scrutiny or challenge because they are like for like, or they're straightforward, or they don't have an implication.
Every head of service has to scrutinise each of their own posts, and the vast majority of them are just straightforward. So scrutiny, yes. Challenge, no. Not really. There isn't a lot of challenge. Can I ask that question? Do we challenge each other? Challenge each other on other things. So the interesting conversation about how much accountability do managers want, how much IT systems do they want, because there's a lot of work in that. I suppose my question around that would be, we're talking about head teachers whose job is to be leaders of learning and to be in school. How much time do I want them to be spending filling in forms? Not too much. If they're a business manager, like a secondary head teacher, that would be different, but they don't. So then I'd be challenging Greg's team about how much admin hours primary head teacher would have. But in general, those conversations happen with somewhere else. So as part of the EAP, the only time that we look carefully at posts is when it's been raised by other services to us, and then we've got to make a decision around what our answer to that is.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to move into prototyping now. I'm going to bring it in the role modelling ideal again. I will be in danger of working this out for you, like I know what's best. So I'm going to get you to tell me what you think the best way to do this exercise is. So the overall plan is a brown paper in five stations, in four or five stations. And that is for a group of mixed, we're going to do it mixed people to come up with four or five different groups to come up with the new prototype, just using the different colour-coded pieces of paper for HR, finance, SMT, or whatever new labels you want to create, and then get you to feedback and then consolidate all of that. And I'm just wondering whether we need five to do that, and whether. So I guess my first question is: it sounds as though it would be useful to do mixed groups, as opposed, because this is about do you do it in your roles? But then that's you always just focusing on your role. Do you now get together with other people in a mixed group? to try and work on something together, because it sounds as though it might be difficult for 32 of us to just come up with one prototype right now. It maybe needs people to have discussion. But do we need 4 or 5, or should we try and get it down to 3 groups? 3 groups? Yeah? And so the way I'd like to do this is we want to get a spread of people across. What I'd like to do is if I could ask service to stand over here. If I could ask finance to stand here. IBL terms, reducing top-down monitoring systems, because it's about sometimes through time as the industrial evolution has moved on and organisations have grown in scale, we've got these layers of organisations and people at the top needing visibility in the information, and people spend a lot of time passing information up the way and can sometimes wonder why I need to add value over here, but I'm doing an awful lot of data up the way. And one of the things in IBL is thinking about what's really value-added information, being clear on the purpose of why people are collecting this information. Why do people need it, and is it a better way of doing it, and how do you ensure that people spend most of the time adding value, not compiling data? So I've not heard a huge amount of that today, but we keep it in terms of when we're doing stuff like this. Clear criteria for design. When David Marquis would stand on the submarine and say, when someone would say, I intend to do this, 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 and this, you go, okay, tell me what tells you that's the right thing to do. Well, I've done this, 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 and this. What's your criteria? What's the criteria that HR need, the evidence, etc., of what finance needs? You've got some of it, we'll put the contributions up on the walls, you can come over and look at them. Just be clear on clear criteria and evidence to support this. Focus on excellence. We're not saying, what we say in IBL is, it's sometimes if we just focus on avoiding errors, there can't be any errors, everything has to be right first time, what that actually does is it creates a different bias in our brains, because it creates a bit of fear of consequences, and actually the more you try and avoid errors, then actually sometimes the more you can make them. It's about focusing on excellence and being positive about risks and being balanced about what really are the risks and how can we work to mitigate them, rather than just trying to avoid them, because that can create too many controls, too many scenarios, too many things that we can't cater for. thinking long term, people talked earlier about the long term impact of slippage and the long term impact of short term contracts and things like that. And short early conversations heard quite a bit about that, needing to see, rather than lots of meetings or meetings after 2 months, whatever, why there's not these short early conversations to just stop things getting to a point where they then have to. There's long because conversations could have happened. So think about these in terms of inspiring the environment that makes it easy for people. Job done. Sometimes that thinking about environment means thinking about the processes, the roles, what needs to go to role description, how do the roles need to be defined? Has anyone got a shared goal, a shared purpose to this? And relationships. That can sometimes help you think about things you might need to put in place. Often it's about leaders needing to think about, it's more about sharing information and the impact of people do, like HR saying, have you considered this, you know there's a risk to that. It's about sharing information rather than giving instructions and telling people what to do. But share information for them to make informed decisions. Practical rather than personal consequences, if there's not compliance, rather than people working in fear, because we want people to want to take accountability rather than push it away and blame. And one of the things I've heard people say is there's not enough recognition when we're doing it really well, when budget managers are managing their budgets really well, can we have more recognition? So that's all part of making it safe. So think about these things too. So you're bringing
Friday, it can just be whenever it arrives and it'll be up there, and
and we can run a report from the system that gets the talent link, and that can get fed back into the SMT if they want to put information in the process.
Okay, so first of all, thoughts on this, and then we'll begin to compare. You were nodding there, Shannon.
I think that seems evidently sensible, and I do think that even though it's coming to HATA service at a really early stage, mm-hmm. if a short conversation circumvents the whole process.
I asked whether my exception, if it goes to HIT service, SMT, or is it service manager?
Well, we were saying by exception, that would depend on the conditions you want to create around it, whether it's the service manager, because whoever it is, the team leader could be a budget holder, we don't know. So if that person in the pink budget holder is less than the service manager, you might want the service manager, or you may even want it to be the head of service, depending on what complexities there is or what the feedback has been that you need somebody else to make that final decision. So it depends on.
Is it a brokering
paper? Could be. Or it might be the finance in a way resource then, or HR in a way resource then that's been getting discussed elsewhere, and the budget holder and the service manager have not been privy to that. And therefore we've got a bigger picture that we think whatever they're proposing might impact on, and therefore somebody more senior needs to make that call.
Because the language you said, HR plans approved, I thought you were original.
Well, HR are saying they've been checked.
Okay, so checked,
consulted, yeah. Right. We've been consulted, so it's part of that. When you submit the justification form, it'll be a revised version to say the budget holder or whoever the manager is has discussed with finance and HR. We'll just put it out. Just so there's an audit trail.
So it could be a tick box, consulted and no issues, or consulted and X and X and
Y. Do you want a big massive forum? We just wanted it to be very clear for audit purposes that the accountable manager who's submitting it has actually done it. And that they're not relying on a phone saying, well, I never got that phone call. They've actually put it down somewhere. Because otherwise there's no audit or trail to say that they actually did it.
I feel that was enough evidence.
Because what applies to the current form is there's a question, is it happening, consulting, blah, 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 blah. It's almost as if it's the wrong question, because then you can just say, no, it's still send it. And then you have to follow up, it's not even an option. It's if you want us to go through, you have to have done it,
yeah.
And you have to have shown your evidence.
And as long as it's on that revised justification, recruitment know they've got authority to release.
Okay. Right, I'd like you to say, because you've got good knowledge of the process, I'd like to stay here for us to help where some of this, because you know this clearly, so then you'll know where you'll help, if you help show us the same difference. So I'm now going to ask, where are we?
Sorry, your name is?
Fiona.
If you could help us understand what you came up with, and we're trying to look at what's the same or different thing from what's called the negotiation we need to do.
Well, it's fairly similar. We've got the recruitment manager deciding to meet the place. Yes, I want to. So then, conversations with head of service, finance, HR, acquired. Release just going to be conversation time, all the conversations, just learning.
check for the skills register was different because they were doing that. They were getting the manager to do that.
Mm-hmm.
We were saying that the project manager would check the HR.
So if I would like to ask a question, how realistic is that to put that to managers? Because what are they going to see? Enough information to make an informed decision. It's another thing for the accountant and manager to do. If they see something and it's quite anonymous information, so there's a grade 4 in the job plan floating around, they're going to have to be raising that to the HR person anyway. I'm just wondering from the collective view about whether that's part of the sense of speaking to HR, or whether that's something that we could realistically expect the manager to do.
Discussed here, and obviously it's not my scenario, but certain people in this team thought that discussing skill register with every single group and informing the people as anyone on the skill register that they produce was going to be a lot of resources within the teams. I think that's why they thought that we could put on
If you change the process, the view was that HR services team would have every recruitment manager contacting us to say, I've got a vacancy, I might be filling it. Can you tell me what the parameters are? Is that realistic in terms of will we be available and can we actually deal with the load of every single manager?
If you look back from the other perspective, we're saying that we have to do an HR check anyway. You have to check in with HR anyway. It's whoever they check in with. We'd be expected to have that oversight of what's on the skills register or what's coming up through job families. So it's not every recruiting manager reporting specifically to talk about the skills register, because we're actually saying that the process is that we should be doing a pre-recruitment assessment of HR anyway.
I think the key lies the HR review day discussing the skill register and implementation and how it's worked for me in the past before. But part of your previous recruitment assessment, before that, you put your checks to finance to make sure that, right, I think I've got the money to get me off. Go speak to my HR contact and they then say to me, put on the redeployment. You might have to consider that redeployment. That's part of that. I didn't think you could do anything else with that.
So it's part of the dialogue with the HR.
HR checks, along, HR colleagues will quite rightly have knowledge and access to every redeployment. Well, they should have, and that should be that conversation.
I'm just wondering what others think, because this is an important point about where that responsibility is.
I think Sarah's idea, she's not here anymore, was that was the conversation at that point. It was some sort of portal where you could go and say, I'm looking for somebody in the care job family at GE4. There are 4 available. Oh, that means I now have to have a conversation. It's not everybody making a conversation first. It's based on the information that was in that maintained system.
So it's before they even contact HR, they've done a pre-check.
Uh-huh. But that would need something in existence. Platform.
So I'd like to
hear
what's
the pressure to pull? So if that's an assurance list, you can adapt that to the database. If we're using Dash, which probably is just secure, which is what we're using as an IPTC platform, then certainly that can search.
Job family. I wouldn't mind having a check inside of the team. As a page document's gone and you're replacing it with a click date new form, or click with somebody I need to do something else.
To send you to 4-H.
So you need to link to kind of up to more resources to start the whole process.
I think it's to do with, getting out kind of culture and the environment for that, and that would be my expectation for managers might be that they would know that those were the objects that we were trying to do and that and that. And I don't know if they were doing that, but they were doing that just in the area that we would be able to change to what the process was and managers expectations.
And I think it's really important to tease out the different views on that, because if we're going to go down that route, then you are the representative stakeholder to represent those views. And if I'm honest, I think that's really helpful to hear that you'll be willing to do that, because I think that it's actually one way of ensuring that the job family framework actually allows us to use the flexibility that it gives us to deploy people.
I just think it's putting that step in the process. You already call in HR, you have to call in HR after they view that document or not. So why putting that step in the process? I don't know.
So,
if
there's no
one
on it,
you can really need to call in HR. Well, you have to call in HR anyway for your discussion with a room here.
Changes that's known to the budget holder, then you could follow that process where they do the check on the platform and it goes straight to public. If it's not like for Mike, or they're trying to do something slightly different, and then there would be that conversation with HR about workforce planning, what else have you considered, have you looked at that, or finance have said you've not got budget at that level, so you maybe need to redesign. Because you've got money for this grade, but you've not got it for that grade, then there's discussion. It doesn't go any, it doesn't have to go to the head of service, it just needs to be between those three to actually sort it. And I can still go to portal after that.
So sorry, just to be clear, recruiting manager service on the data.
Finance. Sorry,
is that being there?
Finance, HR, and the who's the recruitment manager if they're the budget holder. Need to be satisfied that they've got what they need. If there's no exceptions or anything, it doesn't need to go near the head of service. It can just go to the portal, but if it's like for like and there are no circumstances or changes, then like a teacher, you need a teacher, then it should just be, is there anybody on the compulsory teacher transfer list? If yes or no. If there's no, go straight to portal.
Yeah, I think the head of service has to have involvement. They have the court oversight of what's going on across the text.
The budget holder's responsible.
The budget holder doesn't know what's happening in the OT. The head of service does. So if the OT have got a certain direction of travel, shall be with that on the budget holder.
Yes, they would need to be able to know that in order to replace a teacher. I'd be looking at 700 courses.
So we haven't discussed teachers, we think teachers are different, but for other posts, say, well, we are overspending in the council, so say
we're not overspending
in the council. The council is overspending.
Yeah, but not
in the CS. No, the council is overspending, so say you need to make a decision,
swap from the post. We're already going straight to that default position spot, making a process on the basis of some people doing stuff, like overspending, that we're not.
Well, has to be on the ballot budget.
Well, absolutely.
So there needs to be some oversight.
But is that not part of the culture before that, if there's been an EOT decision that you can't fill vacancies? Then that's an instruction that goes out to everybody.
How is the budget going to find that out?
Well, it'll need to be communicated.
Okay.
So then they know somebody's left or can't fill it.
So say it's not blanket, say it's we're still in there because it's the refuse collectors. So we're still doing refuse collectors because they're acquiring. There has to be corporate oversight.
Yeah, there will be corporate oversight, but not at the point of somebody recruiting a teacher.
Sorry, so we're not talking to teachers. We accept it's not the teachers because if the fair side of staffing standard, that's what you could do. But if the council decides to stop filling vacancies or certain areas, I think the service is the corporate oversight of that.
So the example I gave non-teacher was we put in for additional admin hours and it was not right because the decision somewhere further up had been taken, the admin hours would have been cut. Now I would have adjusted my thinking if I'd known that in advance. It's something about communication coming from the EOT to stop us from filling in any process because we know it's a no.
Communication should come out
to allow us to fill forms and correct it and do our workforce plan. Not for us to do our workforce plan and then take it in service to say that things have changed.
So I can completely relate to what Scott's saying. However, that's what we find in organisations is because that's a real concern, but that is because directors and because there is not a proper communication, proactive communication process of creating visibility across services and public holders from positions. So I guess from a challenge point of view is if that continues, it's continually allowing, it's letting directors off the hook with their, one of the key roles of being an effective leader is to be an effective communicator, which is not holding information, but sharing information, and that's encouraging. How do you stop that encouraging directors to continue to hold information and not share? But it's a cultural thing, and it's how do you get to the point where you can trust that that's happening, and that budget holders have that information. And I guess that's what we're talking about here. Mm-hmm.
So if the EOT were to make a decision that there's an overspend somewhere else, the EOT discussion could be that the chief exec's expectations are that executive directors go back to their SMTs and they work out within their service where they think they might be putting in place a recruitment piece or fixed term contracts, and that's the decision that then has to be communicated to people who are then recruiting. So, because I know that we try to do the exempt lists of course.
This whole process feeds into a lot of what we do on a daily basis. So having a formalised process is an advantage to us. And that's why having that kind of check would work for us as well. But then, as Scott said, it's a part of the overall check. So it's definitely something that we're happy to work with it. It's something that we do actively on a daily basis and we're very, very involved in.
So we're looking for volunteers on it. Tina, you've been involved in the program yourself in terms of the representing service finance and some of these areas where we've got this feeling and this degree of who's doing the check. Do you be happy to do that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Any other intentions anyone wants to share just in terms of what you can see as an opportunity to share or re-educate others? If you're happy all to take the time to look at a revision coming out and feed any feedback through. So I think
after this, there'll be a green who can represent the different finance services and HR to be able to feed your feedback to our central point within, say, services, and then to be looking at the draft that comes out of this, feed anything else through back to the HR team so that you're continually, that you're knowing that you're getting a second chance to feedback on this, the iteration that comes out of this.
I also don't sort of manage the expectations. I don't know if you can see that by the end of October we're going to test pilots, because education and children's services is a large service, and all the managers that actually have to understand the conditions that are going to be different, what changes in behaviour are going to be expected from them, what the new ways of working are. So I think we have to build an appropriate implementation period so that we can raise awareness, deal with the concerns and the noise that there might be about changes. So I think we have to have a good lead-in for a whole idea. And I think that without giving a date today, I think the project, the short-line working group, whatever you want to call it, will need to consider what needs to happen to give this pilot the best chance of success. So how do we take the messages out? How much resource of that will it take? And once we've done that, we'll then be able to put the plan in place. I think there's no point in rushing out the process if it is. A few more months isn't going to make that much difference if it's actually about giving it the ideal conditions for a successful pilot.
So I guess the overall commitment is everyone who's here today will see the next iteration of this as a draft proposal to be able to give more feedback into a central representative of Reserve HR and Finance for a smaller group of people to then take that forward.
Okay.
So that's it as far as we've met. In terms of remarkables and boiling money, it's really sort of got to the point in helping us about group creation. So we're speaking there. But we are planning some other changes throughout the EKC to try and help bring all the stakeholders together in this way and understand perspectives. All I'd ask you to do before you leave, and then you can come back again, is just on your way out, Kirsty is going to give you colour-coded post-it notes. So green again for finance, pink for service, and orange for HR. And if you could do the following on your post-it notes, so this is no group thing, you'll just come, you'll write it down, and then you'll just put it on here when you leave. So there's two questions we'd like you to answer, so you're using two post-it notes. First question is, how confident are you that it is high level prototypes will better deliver to your needs and address the current issues? So I'm just asking you to mark it on a scale of 1 to 5, 5 being very confident and 1 being not confident in terms of where we've got to today. Well, how confident are you that the high level prototype will better deliver to your needs and address the current issues? If you could write a number, and beside that number, if you could just write a comment as if there's anything that you think is missing or what comment you want to make about what it will take to give you more confidence, what you think is needed, then please write it and come and post it up here. And the second question is, how did you find the approach today in terms of this ideal chain approach? And if you could just write down again from 5 to 1, 5 being excellent, 1 being poor, and just a comment beside your post-it note what could make it better. That would be some good feedback. We will send it a second monthly, but it's always good to get it fresh in case some people don't feel it second monthly. So we're going to put these up here, and if you could just post your post-it notes before you leave, that would be great. And I'll hand it back over to Karen and Sharon for any closing.
Well,
hopefully
I'll see you and thank everybody for coming along today. We really value your input. It's been some really lively and interesting discussion, and it's good to have some of the agreement that pushes out the issues that are important and allows us to tackle those. So I'd like to thank Nick and Kirsty for coming up. Thank you very much. We're all going to design them today and being here to facilitate the workshop today. And for those who have always been to the HR, OD and finance, I know we've had a few discussions in Japan for today about your contribution we've been doing today. So thank you very much everybody. I hope you've enjoyed it. This is the end, this is the beginning, and have a safe journey. I went back to work for
Anne said, and we'll let you give us a lot of time today. You're already started doing your evaluation, so thank you again, and we shall talk to you soon.
Just remember, how did you find the approach? What is five? Might be better, what we improve, what can make it better? And how confident are you that where we've got some effective opportunities to address issues of the scale of 1 to 5 again? And any comments around the missing or needs to still be addressed that we've not talked about? Thank you very much. And then part of that, it's about understanding. The reason we call this a chain is because it's about getting different people from the different roles involved in the process, getting them imagined into all the different roles, and getting them all to say, this is what I need, this is what gets in the way for me, this is what I need from other people, this is what I need in this position. Challenging yourself to think about, do I need to be an approver or do I just need to check stuff? Do I actually need to be able to see this before it's approved, or do I just need the information after? Or what is it I actually need? But if I'm maybe going to give up something, what is it that I need from other people and other roles in order to give me the comfort in order to release that? So it's making sure that you can all open and honestly get your views out on the table. And we'll make that easy for you. So it's not about consensus, it's about honesty, constructive honesty. And it's my job to make sure that I'm getting that from you and not feeling that you're worrying about what anybody else might think. Okay, and we'll talk about that in our working together principles. We want to leave some criteria, so we want to create a tick list of the things that this needs to achieve. So what's our tick list? We want to make sure that we'll do a bit of that. And then we get you into really looking at what the flow could be. And we also need to look at what the conditions need to be put in place. What's the environment that's needed? What conditions need to be put in place by leadership to make sure that people comply with this and follow this? What will make it easy for people to do this new way that we've come up with? Does that make sense? Okay? So that's what we're working on. And then what does that mean for how we take all this forward? Because there'll be some work to do to consolidate it all afterwards. And then it's what are the key ingredients that will go into that plan? That's what we're going to do today. So in terms of working together, before we do the session, why don't we do introductions and then come back to working together? Because essentially, Gillian, do you have some post-it notes on the table just in case we need to come back? And so in terms of working together principles, this is just so we can all make sure that it's called ground rules, but it's that sort of terms of engagement. So we all go, hang on, what we can all contribute in the local space. Here's my starters for 10, and I'll just ask you to add any others. If you just leave some post-it notes here, if you have a minute to write anything down and add to them, so that you're not, if I ask you to say it out loud, part of intent-based leadership is to create openness and avoid what you call groupthink, where people sort of, we don't want, it's not about people feeling that they have to conform. So one of the ways to do that is to give people space to write down their own thought and put it up, and nobody needs to know you said it, and I can read it out, or you can read it, it's up to you. But the point is, it encourages openness. So let's start off with. So part of our working together principles is that we need to create an environment, a safe environment for you today to be able to contribute honestly, and the only thing we ask is constructively, and to explain why, not just what you need, but why, and why that's important. So we need to create an environment to make it easy for you to contribute, easy for you to be honest, and that continuous improvement mindset is something that don't be good to get better. It's always about trying to improve on things. So everyone, to make it easy for everyone to contribute and use ideas, in that essence there's a bit of sort of hierarchy out the door type thing. It's just about everyone having an equal contribution. And understanding and respecting different perspectives. Part of chain is about getting perspectives on the table. Often we go into meetings and we can tend to move into the way agendas for meetings are often as headings, and people just get straight into talking about the issue and their opinion and then it's going into task. So that's interpret and then act. And what we want, what we do with intent-based leadership is try to get everyone to start with what do we all see, because we all see things differently, we all hear different things from our client groups, we all experience different things, so we just want to make sure we get that on the table first before we move into opinions. It's a bit like get the evidence, then move into opinions and thinking. So respecting these different perspectives, listening to one another, and I'd encourage you to give yourself permission to clarify. So clarifying is about what makes you say that. What's the answer for that? Could you explain that a little bit more? It's what I mean, so clarify from one another. If you don't understand, it's not because you're stupid, it's because it's maybe using words that you know means different things to different people. So it's just a bit clarifying to understand. And particularly for those of you in a senior leadership role, is really focused today on what can you do to create the clarity in the room for people around priorities, around a balancing act, I'm just going to talk about that in a minute, of balancing service needs with statutory and budgetary requirements. And so if you are, make sure if you can hear any misunderstandings or if there's any myths, please actively seek to clarify. Everyone's trying to be able to do new things in a different way. There's a lot of metaphors we can use for that, but we don't need to around just trying to find new things to do things. But if the key was that if you always do what you've always done, you'll only get what you've always got. Consider, for those of you who are currently approvers in the process, is getting you to consider whether approving is the only way to get information and visibility of something, and whether actually you could be involved afterwards, because it's about the visibility, it's not about the function of approving. It just so happens that you've become an approver simply because sometimes controls get put in, and it tends to be that the higher up you are, the more you tend to have to approve things. And what we're trying to do is unpick all of that to see when that's needed and when it's not. And to keep to commitments and agreed actions. And the final thing I would say is just if we come up with something new and it is about pushing more authority, there's people who are working at the where the need is and where the information is, then what can we do to give people permission to take initiative on that, to feel comfortable to take on that role? To make sure that there's nothing that's getting in the way from them in terms of thinking, well, what's the consequences for me if I do that? It's not procrastinating over decisions. So that's the working together tool. We've got some post-it notes in. If there's anything else you want to add, it might be you're happy with that, but if there's anything else you want to add, come forward, pick up a post-it note, write on it, and either give it to me to put up for you or put it up yourself, whatever will make it feel safe for you. I'm just going to give you a couple of minutes to do that. Set of scales. So you've got all these different roles from the service teams, recruiting managers, budget rollers, service finance, corporate finance, all the way up to the executive officer team. And then it's balancing act. You've all got different priorities, needs, and it's the statutory requirements versus public needs and expectations. And that's what we're asking you to balance today. And think about what it is. Where is the right balance? Have we struck the right balance? So too much this way, that way, how do we get trying to get it so people can make informed decisions and the right decisions. I'll leave others to say more about that. Thank you. Do you want me to start or do you want to share? And you know, I was just stunned working with caseworkers the other day at how intelligent and how well educated you all are working at the front line, and it's just ridiculous some of the decisions that they can't make. And if you think of it in life, I was telling my mother-in-law the other day about my mum and dad in their 70s, and she was moaning about my dad the other day about, oh, he just doesn't initiate anything. I have to do all the thinking for him. I was like, yeah, because you've controlled him his whole life. And it happens in life, it's that basic psychology. If the more you get used to not making decisions and not thinking for yourself, then you begin to check out. And you begin to default, and it's about how you create the environment to bring all of that in. That's about safety and pre-usage, so about sound judgment. You cannot, in government, they try to account, people in policy try to account for every single eventuality that might happen. And they can't, because human beings, they're dealing with human beings and people applying for this and that and whatever. And it's about creating new clear criteria to guide judgment, broad criteria, being clear on the evidence, the clear criteria that you need to fulfill. Help people make decisions because you cannot cater for everything. And that's what you've got more focus here, which is great. So hopefully it shouldn't be too difficult. It's just about getting everybody to share what they need. Sorry to extend it. Anything else you want to say, Karen, on the context, EKC context? To ask Sandra to top up a little bit on what I'm about to say right now. At this point, we'll be looking to sit down. Aspects of intent-based leadership, because it's based, a lot of it is based on psychology and on the latest of what we know about the neuroscience of the brain as well. But it actually all started with Captain David Marquet, who was the captain of a submarine in the US Navy, and he turned it from the worst performing submarine in the US Navy to the highest performing in the US Navy. And as a result of that, David has written a book called Turn the Ship Around. It's an international bestseller. He's been voted one of the 12 best-selling business books by the New York Times. And David has started a consultancy about delivering intent-based leadership to organisations. Today we're not talking about submarine, because what Remarkable's job is, as the licensee, is to turn it, take it from the submarine to the workplace. So it's to make it real to you, and that's why we're working on a real topic today, using the principles to apply to it. And I'm not saying you have to stick so rigidly to them, but it's all based on the psychology of people and how they behave. But what the big thing for David when he was a cat, he knew submarines really, really well, and then he was put on this lowest performing submarine where he didn't know the submarine at all. And one day when he was given an instruction, when they were part of a training environment, now bearing in mind it was a nuclear submarine, so they could press the button on a nuclear missile. And that was the only, and so what he discovered on a training mission is he was telling them to go so many knots ahead and to, this is where my lack of physics and technical knowledge lets me down, but he told them to turn so many knots ahead. And the point is, that wasn't actually an option, yet they all did it. And he watched, and he could see confused heads and whatever, but they did it. And he saw the person at the front line, looking confused because he'd now been told by three people who'd passed it down the line to do this. And then Navy shouted to him, and then he said, "What's the problem?" There isn't that dial. And so he said to his next officer, their next officer, "So why did you give the command? Did you know that was wrong?" And they were like, "Yeah." And then, "So why would you give that command?" "Because you told us to do it. Because you're the captain. That's the way it is." And that's when he realised that he had to change the whole way, because he's like, "I don't know anything about how to run this nuclear submarine, because I only knew about this one. So what are we going to do? Because otherwise I'm going to be giving really, really poor instructions." And it was about making sure that the whole practices were around how you empower people at the front who've got the data and the information, whether it's near the customers, the clients, the public, whoever it is. Who's near the action? Who's got the information? What do they see? Because that's the biggest thing. What do you see that tells you and helps you inform the decisions? And that's how it came about. So I just want to take you through some very basic principles. Because PKC is the first council that we've been doing work with. We do work with police. David's been doing work with oil companies and whatever. I'm beginning the transformation, and we've just finished one with a Scottish public service body as well, who describes them as transformational in the practices that they've been able to put in place. And it all starts with a very basic principle here of what we call the three C's. And that's in order to give more control to people, you can't give more control unless they have the clarity of what are we trying to achieve here and what's the order. And we talked about the balancing, the scales over there. The clarity for PKC is you need to understand the statutory requirements as well as and the strategic priorities as well as your own public needs and service needs. And that's the balancing act. But you have to have that clarity. And equally, you have to have the technical competence, which we translate for you as the knowledge and expertise of your service areas or of HR processes or of the finance and accountancy requirements. So, and if you don't have that, if you have the control and clarity, but you don't have the confidence, there isn't the competence there, then what you get is lots of mistakes and mistaken activity, focusing in the wrong direction, doing things that might not, or they're not mistakes, but actually they're not what we need. And then if you have the control and the competence, but the people don't have the clarity to make these decisions, then things are misaligned again. So it's either mistakes or things misaligned, either doing the wrong things or not doing the right things right. And so this is about trying to push more control down, but at the same time you can only do that, you have to tune it to say, well, what's the clarity people need and what's the confidence they need to have? Do we have it? And if they don't have it but we still think we should have more control, then what are we going to do to give back to them? And often it's not about sending people on training courses and development, it's about directors and leaders communicating and being regular with what they communicate in a clear way that everyone understands. So what he developed was this ladder of leadership, And we use the ladder a lot as a tool, because everything David does is about practice. It's not about sitting. The development that we're trying to do isn't just about sitting people in rooms and giving them theory about leadership. It's about helping them think about the tools and techniques and habits to go and try. Because the more you practice something, the more you create new pathways in the brain, the more you're likely for it to become second nature. And so one of the key tools to building new habits is he's built the ladder. And that's about moving people from a position of tell me what to do, or where the leader is saying, you know, my job is to tell you what to do, and to move them up the ladder. So today we're about to do some stuff about, so what do you see, first of all? We want to make informed decision making. What do you see? So we're going to ask you what you see about the current process to help create some informed decision making about the new way of doing it. Then moving them from what do you see, because that's gentle for people who are not used to making decisions up to this is what I think. Okay, this is what I think we should do, these are my ideas. To I would like to, that takes them a bit further forward in terms of psychological ownership. What's that? And then the key one he talks about this as the sweet spot, is moving people to I intend to. So that's where he got them to on the submarine. He didn't give orders anymore. What he had was people taking responsibilities for the area and coming to him in the morning saying, right, Captain, today I intend to do this, 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 and this. And he said, okay, so tell me what's the right thing to tell me. Why you think that's the right thing to do? Well, I think it's the right thing to do because of this, 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 this. So they had their criteria, and they gave their intention, and he could then decide. Having a party, having a party. Okay, go ahead. So he talks about that as a sweet spot, because you can still intervene as the leader, but the psychological ownership sits with the person, because they've done the whole thought process around it. You're just merely checking in. But you can also then push it forward even further into the I've done, which is letting someone make a decision and they tell you afterwards. So the I've done is immediately afterwards, or a very short time afterwards, and then the I've been doing might be 3 months down the line. Okay? Now, we're not saying that every single thing you do has to be I intend to. What we're saying is that's the sweet spot, because you as a leader can still intervene, but the individual still feels as though I've got ownership of this, psychological ownership, accountability. It's not about blame. I made this, I was the one that gave these intentions, I advised this, with this evidence, this thought process, to make a decision. So in terms of what that might look like today, what we're asking to think about is a prototype, where essentially there's people who might need to be consulted beforehand, terms of checks. So that has to happen beforehand. There might be some intention. Then there's the decision bit that sits between this, the decision, the approval. And then there's those who actually just need the information, what they need is visibility, and we could get that afterwards. And that's what we're asking to think about. Where does that all need to sit? Where do the different parts of the process need to sit on the ladder between the budget holders and the senior management? Or you know, what's charge role in here, what's finances role in here. So that's it in a nutshell, and then there's just some key principles which we've got around the room on another folder things as well. I've talked to you about three of them so far. I hope you can get better, simple mindset. Leaders making it safe, not adding stress, so making it safe for people to take initiative, safe for people to give ideas, making it safe if you make a mistake, so that you fess up and then you can all work together to do something about it as opposed to trying to hide it and sort it out in a different way. And the other ones I want to talk to you about are pushing authority to information. So that's about, as we've talked about, tuning and deciding where does the control need to sit. And in general, it's getting as close to the front line as possible where the information is and where the knowledge of the services are. But equally, you could argue front line is also those in finance who've got their head around the budget situation, those in HR who know, well, this is how many people we've got internally, so you could argue that can work in different aspects. You're tuning and then finally actuating new thinking, not thinking into new action. And we mean this in the sense of you can only change when you actually start to do something. You can't change by sitting around this room thinking about it. And a lot of training you go on is where you sit around thinking about something in leadership development. But this is about giving you tools to go and do. This is about you taking something and piloting it and learning from it. You will whether you take this on or not, it's all about what you learn from doing it, and then you'll begin to see the benefits and what it feels like. So that's what all of this today is about. So I think I'll come to other bits later on. The only other thing I wanted to say is also thinking about a high-performing team. This is not about the team which is finance, or the team which is HR, or your service team. This is more about thinking one team, one council, one team. This is based on Lynn Scione, I think is how you pronounce it. Five dysfunctions of a team, we prefer to call it high-performing teams. And what it really is, just something to think about as you're building this prototype, hello there, is the basic foundation of any high-performing team is that there's trust, that people have clarity, and that there's transparency. And actually, when you look at what trust means, it's not about confidence in people's ability. That's about confidence. Trust is about people being transparent about their intentions. So you know what the intentions of your directors and senior managers are, and they're clear about their intentions to you. And they know what your intentions are with regard to your budget and what you're about to do. That creates trust. When that becomes hidden and masked and information is stored and held, and that's when trust begins to crumble. So trust, clarity and transparency are the first basis of one team. If you have that, you're more likely to get people, and if you create a safe environment, you're more likely to get challenged and debate, because that's good, because you get better informed decisions, because people are able to say what they see, what they hear, what they know, not just what they think. That leads to more commitment. When people feel more psychological ownership and commitment over something, they're more likely to be accountable for it, particularly when structures are then put in place to create the environment to make it easy for them to have that accountability and to exercise that control. And ultimately what sits at the top is even if you have all of that, you have to have shared goals and collective results. So it's not enough about people having priorities over here, and other people have priorities over here, and somehow they're not. You need to know it all in order to have shared goals. And that's where we're trying to get to. Sandra, what would you like to say in terms of how that tops up with the learning in terms of some practices, but we'll break that down for you later when we get into the prototyping. But just in terms of what I've said, just to understand what questions there might be, can you just do your fists again? So we've got three, so we also go to who? So, I'm going to go to this idea.
I think I understand it,